Assalamualaikum and hi, I bid to Associate Professor Dr. Suyan Shah. I am Shahira Shazana Hamsha, together with my group members Nurul Najwa binti Che Abdul Haziz, Amanda Holy Grace Peter, and Nur Hanisa binti Ramli from Group 9 will be presenting our group work assignment. Moving on to the introduction, what is language awareness? Language awareness refers to the language knowledge forms and function that learners eventually develop as they internalize specific language knowledge. According to ALA definition, it is described as the explicit understanding of language and conscious perception and sensitivity in language learning, teaching, and use. Basically, it pertains to how every teacher utilizes words in their teaching and learning materials, making them attainable and accessible for the learners. Next is the definition of critical discourse analysis, CDA. So basically, CDA is a research method that investigates the role of language in the production and regulation of the social environment, according to Dremel 2014. In addition, Wodak and Mayer 2009, as cited in Mule 2018, also affirmed that CDA is a qualitative analytical approach that is used to critically describe, analyze, and explain how discourses build, perpetuate, and legitimate social inequities. It is undeniably significant as it assists the use of critical thinking in diverse societal circumstances and unravels the underlying politics based on the society's social systems, beliefs, and understanding. Moreover, it can also be utilized to comprehend any text related to the social situation or problem. There are three levels of CDA practices. Firstly is discourse as social practice. It entails ideological consequences and hegemonic processes in which discourse is involved. It is to ascertain the extent to which social structures shape and affect speech and the type of social activity it is a part of. Second, discourse as discursive practice. It focuses on formal and semantic linguistic characteristics like vocabulary, grammar, cohesion, and a text structure that aid in conveying and interpreting a particular message. Third is discourse as textual practice. It refers to the text development, distribution, and consumption. Speech acts, coherence, and intertextuality should also be considered when analyzing text syntax, vocabulary, and structure.
Hello everyone, I am Najwa and I will continue with the selection of material. As we all know, gender stereotypes are present even until today. It is a dinosaur concept, but unfortunately still rampant in our society. It heavily affects how we live and especially harsh on how individuals receive education based on their sex. This is a very serious topic. Because of that, we have chosen an article entitled How Gender Stereotyping Affects Human Rights as our teaching material. It was written by Penn Howard in September 2019. Generally, this article discusses about how gender stereotyping affects the status of human rights. And the most important part is it causes violence and prejudice to human rights. Gender stereotypes impede on women's access to a quality education. The stereotype is that women are economically tied to men. Hence, they are thought to be less likely to seek education and job as highly valued professionals. Based on the Fairclough framework, the selected text will be analyzed. We will be focusing on three levels of CDA practices. The first one would be discourse as social practice. Languages play a significant role in communication, and it is typically related to power and hierarchy. The first part of this practice is it requires students to evaluate how the material contributes to a specific role representation and whether it is contradicts or opposes their expectation. Secondly, it concerns how the author's ideological position influences material coverage. Lastly, it relates to how the material reinforces or modifies the student's ideological attitude and viewpoint. Based on our material, these three aspects can be used to scrutinize and question the author's social identities in writing and how gender stereotyping affects human rights. First, the contribution of real-life depiction and expectations of selected material and topic-centered can be evaluated. Second, we can question the author's ideological viewpoint or societal aims based on the article published through the content. Lastly, after reading and comprehending how gender stereotyping affects human rights, assess the impact on students' viewpoint and attitudes to reinforce and enable them to have a rational discussion with classmates.
Hello, my name is Amanda and I will be discussing about this course as discursive practice and textual practice. As for discursive practice, it is focused on the problem of what are people saying in the context of the whole conversation. Basically, it means how the conversation is going. Other than that, discursive practice means we are giving our opinion without being biased. With the three features of discursive practice mentioned by COTS 2006, it is all implemented in our teaching and learning material because it interconnects with the main context of the topic and the author itself elaborate the points fairly and it is not biased. Moving on to textual practice. Textual practice basically means we are looking at the key linguistic features of how the text is produced and provide a better understanding of the overall text. So, based on our teaching and learning material, we can see that the elements of textual practice is being implemented throughout the reading material, which is the points are elaborated analytically and there are comprehensible points that are point out throughout the text that is not being taken out of the main context of the overall text. So that is all from me. Moving on to the next presenter.
The selected material is a reading text titled How Gender Stereotyping Affects Human Rights. This material is utilized for the reading comprehension activity in the well lesson stage. First, students will be instructed to read the text silently. Then, they will be asked to underline the words that are unfamiliar to them. Then, the teacher will summarize the whole content of the reading text. Afterwards, students' comprehension skills will be tested through a short quiz consisting of 6 subjective questions. Consequently, teacher and students will discuss the correct answers for the quiz. Then, finally, they will be given the opportunity to share their views on the reading text and the activity holistically. To relate these activities with the 3 levels of CDA practices, it can be proven that all 3 levels of practices are involved. First, social practice is involved because students will need to express their views on the rights and wrongs of the context of the article, in particular, how gender stereotyping affects human rights, as they did in the short quiz activity. Students would also comment and voice out their opinions regarding whether gender stereotyping might actually have negative effects on human rights in the opinion sharing session. Additionally, students will discuss how the sentence structure in the reading material might help illustrate how gender stereotyping affects human rights. Next is the incorporation of textual practice. So, in order to accurately present their responses and convey their thoughts in answering the subjective questions, students will need to create sentences with the proper semantic and formal aspects. Last but not least, the activities also have the involvement of discursive practice in terms of coherence and intertextuality. Students are required to produce critical thoughts, in order to respond to the subjective questions individually.
Ultimately, we collectively agree and believe that CDA is indeed beneficial for both teachers and students. It helps students to combine their knowledge from diverse fields of study to create unique interpretation and explanation based on their own comprehension. As a result, students are challenged to think critically and creatively and to improve their problem-solving abilities and ideas, leading towards a greater curriculum knowledge. On the other hand, it also enables teachers to add diversity and meaning to the lesson, offering a setting for learning a second language that are more appropriately reflects the language used and motivates students to achieve the learning objective. That is all from us. Thank you.